Bone is a specialized connective tissue that comprises most of the skeleton. It functions to support the entire body, serves as levers to hold the body upright and move it through space, and protects internal organs, including the brain. Further, the bone is a site of hematopoiesis, and one of its critical functions is to serve as a reservoir of calcium and then to regulate its concentration in the blood. Today, we will review some features of bone and its general organization, including cell types. Bones are comprised of two types of bone tissue, compact boned and spongy bone. Compact bone comprises the outer wall of mature bone, while the inner layer or marrow cavity consists of more porous bone, which has multiple names, most often called trabecular, but also spongy and cancellous. It's important to note that all adult bone, whether compact or trabecular, has the same histological structure. All bones are lined on their internal and external surfaces by layers of connective tissue. The periosteum lies the external surface, and it has an outer fibrous layer of dense irregular connective tissue, fibroblasts, and blood vessels to carry metabolites to and from the bone cells. Its inner layer contains osteoprogenitor cells. The endosteum covers the internal surfaces and contains similar cell types, except that it has a sparse, more delicate matrix of collagen. Both of these layers provide nutrition, support, and osteogenic cells. The exception for both layers is the end of long bones, which lack a periosteum, but instead they are lined with articular cartilage, and this is hyaline cartilage. There are two major bone cell lineages. First, the osteoprogenitor cells that will give rise to first osteoblasts and osteocytes are derived from mesenchymal stem cells. And second are the osteoclasts, which are large motile cells derived via hematopoiesis from monocytes. We will briefly discuss each of these cell types. In terms of organization, osteoblasts and most of the osteoclasts are part of the endosteum that lines the bony tuberculae, while osteocytes are found between the bone layers or lamellae. Osteoprogenitor cells derived from mesenchyme are the stem cells of bone. These cells can proliferate and they produce osteoblasts. The osteoblast or bone maker cells mineralize the matrix. They produce the organic components of the bone matrix, including fibroblasts, proteoglycans, type 1 collagen, and glycoproteins. They also secrete osteoid, which is a unique collagen-rich material that forms between the pre-existing bone surface and the osteoblasts. Osteoid can be seen as a lighter staining material next to bone in most H&E sections. These osteoblasts are located in a single layer of cuboidal cells at the surfaces of bone matrix, and they are bound by integrins. Some osteoblasts will differentiate as osteocytes, which are trapped in matrix-bound lacunae, or small spaces or gaps. These are the principal cells in adult bone, and these cells form the continuous system of bone cells. They have critical functions, they maintain the bone matrix, they sense damage or mechanical stress, and they secrete substances that will regulate bone remodeling. These cells have long dendritic processes that will occupy bone canaliculi, the channels that radiate from each lacunae. Now recall that lamellae are layers of bone, and lacunae are the spaces where the osteocytes reside. Thick bone canaliculi allow metabolites to diffuse between osteocytes and blood vessels, and they connect the osteocytes to one another via gap junctions. Let's quickly recap. Osteoblasts reside in the endosteum lining trabeculae, and they secrete osteoid, seen here as a lighter pink substance next to the darker magenta-colored bone. They divide and produce osteocytes, which will extend processes. A matrix will form the bone canaliculi, which can be readily seen by the arrows here in this electron micrograph, and they also can be seen in this image as connecting the adjacent lacunae. Osteoclasts, or bone chewers, are the multinucleate cells derived from monocytes. They require osteoblasts produce factors for activity. Osteoblasts will display the rank L ligand on their surface, which will interact with monocytes, and this is part of what stimulates the fusion of monocytes to form osteoclasts. The essential role of the osteoclasts is to resorb bone matrix during growth and remodeling. They enzymatically form cavities called Halship's lacunae, or the resorption lacunae, and they form surface projections called the ruffled border. Thus, there's a specialized microenvironment for bone resorption. Into this microenvironment, the osteoclasts will pump protons, and this will acidify and dissolve the bone matrix. They also secrete matrix metalloproteases and other enzymes that digest matrix proteins. The activity of the osteoclasts is highly regulated, in part by parathyroid hormone, although this is an indirect regulation, as osteoclasts lack the parathyroid hormone receptor. These two images show both the multinucleate nature of the osteoclasts on the left, and the scanning electron micrograph image on the right shows the ruffled border. This cartoon serves as a summary showing the origins of the three cell types, their locations, and their functions. Now, besides these four bone-specific cell types, the matrix contains other organic components, primarily type 1 collagen, also glycosaminoglycans, proteoglycans, and glycoproteins such as osteonectin, and a number of specific glycoproteins that are critical for promoting mineralization, binding calcium, and even some that serve as hormones. About 50% of the dry weight of bone comes from inorganic materials, and the most abundant is hydroxyapatite, which forms crystals as the first step in calcification. The surfaces of these crystals are hydrated so that there is an exchange of ions between minerals and body fluids. Before we move on to bone remodeling, let's review the structure of adult compact bone. About 80% of our total bone mass is adult compact bone that consists of structures called osteons. These are lamellae that are organized as sheets around central canals called Haversian canals. And these canals contain nerves, blood vessels, and lymphatics. The canals are joined by horizontal or perforating canals called Volkmann's canals. These interconnect the vessels and nerves in the Haversian canals. There are two other important layers, the inner and outer circumferential lamellae that enclose the osteons. Now in this H&E section, you can view the two different canals, the concentric lamellae and the remnants of remodeled osteons, now called interstitial lamellae. We'll talk about the process of bone growth and development in a different video, but as bone grows, it does change shape. And this process is influenced by physical forces and mechanical stress, which is sensed by osteocytes and involves bone being both added and resorbed by osteoblasts and osteoclasts, respectively. However, bone remodeling also takes place constantly with no changes in shape, as osteoclasts will degrade old osteons and osteoblasts will generate new ones. Remodeling rates are high in children, but once growth stops, remodeling will slow. The cartoon to the left illustrates this process. Briefly, osteoclasts will remove old bone and form small tunnels that are invaded by osteoprogenitor cells from the endosteum or the periosteum, and these will develop into osteoblasts that will line the tunnel walls and secrete osteoid. They form osteocytes and then new osteons. The tunnel becomes constricted by layers of new matrix until the lumen exists as a central canal. The dashed lines in Figure A indicate the levels of the structure that are shown more closely in Figure B, while Figure C is an X-ray image showing these different structures. Interestingly, an entire osteon can be rebuilt in 4 to 5 weeks, and this process is critical for functions such as helping to shape the skull as the brain grows or allowing braces to realign teeth in the jaw. Bone formation and bone resorption are critical for normal bone turnover, and maintenance of bone requires a balance between osteoblast and osteoclast function, and control of this process is very complex. Inputs such as leptin, immobilization, and aging inhibit osteoblast activity, while low calcium and lack of estrogen promote bone resorption by osteoclasts. The control of calcium is the overriding factor in altering this balance. Now, not surprisingly, alterations in the balance can cause pathologies. Let's take a very brief look at several different pathologies. Osteoporosis is a disease state in which the activity of osteoclasts outpaces the activity of osteoblasts. And this results in a decrease in bone mass, although the composition of bone matrix is normal. Osteoporosis is associated with a number of factors, including the inability to absorb calcium. Osteopetrosis results from defective osteoclasts, so there are a number of different defects, The osteoclast can lack the ruffled border or have mutations in enzymes important for acidification of house ship's lacunae. Overall, there's decreased bone absorption. And the osteoclasts often do not respond normally to parathyroid hormone. These patients have dense, heavy bones with characteristic overgrowth and thickening of bone as seen here in this H&E section, and the bone is often called marble bone for its appearance. These bones don't undergo normal remodeling from trabecular, or primary bone, to lamellar, or secondary bone, and they are not strong. Instead, because of their disordered architecture, the bones are weak and brittle, and this results in multiple fractures that don't heal very well. The disorder results in a reduced marrow cavity, and it can affect hematopoiesis, giving rise to anemia and infections. Be sure to check out the next video to review bone growth and development.